have shirts that are $15. We have the bags that are $20. And then we have our notebooks that are $5. And we want to thank everybody who has already made a purchase. Thank you so much. Amen. This is what I sent. Sorry, y'all, I'm a little lost. Okay. So then also we have our men's fellowship. They meet every second Saturday morning at 9 a.m. We also have choir rehearsal that are every Saturday at 10:30 a.m. Yesterday, our Kingdom Kids and Young Adults for Christ, we had our fellowship yesterday at Chris Bowl. Yes, it was a great time. I can't remember which team won, but it was a great time. Everyone who attended, thank you so much. And then also our youth and young adult is Sunday is every fourth Sunday. We also dress down during that time as well. We have an email address that you can send all of your birthdays, anniversaries, and special announcements to. That email address is newjerusalemchurch.info@gmail.com. You do not have to wait until that time gets here. You can go ahead and send it in now so we can prepare for that time. So this month of June, we are celebrating Brother Brandon Hardrick. His birthday is June the 11th. Yeah. Also, Pastor Alonzo Adam Jr. is celebrating his birthday June 23rd. And Bishop is celebrating his birthday June 23rd. And then we got a lot of 23rd. Jada Madison is also celebrating her birthday June 23rd as well. Amen. And then we have one more. I'm trying to find it. June 21st, Sister Dodson, yes. We look forward to celebrating those birthdays. All right, and then also we have, Pastor is going to be celebrating his birthday June 21st at 6 p.m. The theme is going to be Harlem Nights. Please go ahead and put that on your calendar. If you have not RSVP, please do so that we can know that you're attending. And if you will be bringing anyone, I do want to let you know that we will not be having anyone under the age of 18. So you must be 18 or older in order to attend. Again, that theme is Harlem Nights. It's 1920s attire. If you do not have that, go ahead and just wear something formal. And then June 8th at 12 p.m., our pastor is asked to speak at a Father's Day luncheon at Cross Keys Church. This location is, yes. The location is 14255 New Halls Ferry Road, Florissant, Missouri, 63033. The tickets are $5 each, and this event is a men's only event. Amen. So again, that's June 8th at 12 p.m. Today starts the celebration of our pastoral anniversary. Yes. We're celebrating our pastor's seventh year of leading and shepherding the flock. We're asking each family for a donation of $250. If you send that in electronically, please go ahead and label that pastor's anniversary. We're asking that everyone please be in attendance today at 3:30 to show love and support to the pastor and his family. Please put these dates in your calendar. That is every Sunday afternoon in June, except for Father's Day. The next date is June 9th, June 23rd, and June 30th. Amen? All right, please mark your calendars for our church picnic, which will be July 27th. Again, that's July 27th, our church picnic from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. This will also be our family and friends weekend. Please go ahead and invite as many people as you can, also for that Sunday service. Now we're going to go ahead and get into our tithes and offering. Yes. So in front of you, you should see a QR code that you can easily scan that with your phone to go ahead and pay your tithes and offering. Reminders that our ways to give is Cash App, $ New Jerusalem, 1977 or the Zelle app, 314-368-7378. But again, it's very easy to go ahead and scan those QR codes and you can send it in that way. Amen. All right, we're going to have Minister AJ come on up and pray over all that was given. Thank you, New Jerusalem.
Amen, amen. Everybody ready to give?
Yeah.
Amen. Sound like only one person ready to give. Is everybody ready to give? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We do have the multiple ways of giving. Where you got the old school way, you put the tithe and the offering in the envelope, or we do have the electronic. I apologize. That's what I was just paying my tithes to as well, just being obedient. And as the ushers come through, I believe they are passing the bucket or just passing the tithes and offering. Amen. You all just passed the bucket. Start learning things along the way, but that's quite all right. Amen, amen. Just grateful that we got some youth in training. Amen, amen. Is everybody being blessed to give? We are, everybody has that time. Amen. Let us bow for prayer. Gracious and heavenly Father, Lord, we just want to thank you, God. We want to thank you for the opportunity, God, to be a blessing, Lord. We want just to thank you, God, for giving us the ability, Lord, to be able to make money, God, to be able to have income, Lord. We don't take that for granted because there are plenty of people who want to work who can't work. And, Lord, we're just grateful, God, continuously, Lord. We ask you that you would take this, Lord, and you would allow us to be a blessing to this ministry and even to others. These blessings we ask in your son Jesus' name, we all say together, amen. 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 We all want to make sure that we're doing things decent and in order. Amen? Amen. Amen. So what we're going to go ahead and do is, I don't think we have any other announcements. If we do, I believe Pastor will address that at this moment. Amen. We're going to go ahead and turn it to the hands of our pastor. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Good morning. You all, I'm trying to get back on track myself. Miss Mari, I think I just sent that. Sorry. All right. It's good to see you all. We are coming into our summer months, and I know during the summer months, many of us are vacationing, and that's a good thing. That's a good thing. You need to rest. Everybody needs to have an opportunity to rest, and I hope and pray that you do have the finances to be able to move and go about and travel the country. But don't forget to keep God first, even in your travels. Don't take your tithe money to vacation with. Amen. Y'all can still smile. We still talking about good stuff. All right. All right. We ain't talking about nobody. We just saying in general. We have a lot of things that are going on, a lot of things that's happening. Good to see so many of you all back. I know we've had death in the family and in different areas, and we're praying for you. It was my understanding. I think you said the repast went well. Amen. Sister Artisha, her mother-in-law passed away, and I know Sister Betty and Sister Earlene also had death in the family, and it's been a lot of that. But one thing I know for sure, everyone who is living, if you don't see the rapture, you're going to die. We try to use different words to make it sound better. You know, people have transitioned and people have went over to the other side, and we got a lot of names for it, but we die. And that's just the absolute truth, and we can't deny that. But hopefully you have your business right with your maker, with God himself, so that when you do make your transition, when you close your eyes on the last time on this side, when you wake up on the other side, you wake up in the comfortable presence of God. One way or the other, you're going to be in the presence of God. Absent from the body, present with the Lord, but I want you to know that God is present in all places. God is present even in hell. He's not affected by it, but he's there. So many people are saying, you know, when you die, you're going to be with the Lord. Yes, you will, but that don't mean that you won't be tormented. So I pray that you have your business fixed. We have a lot of our kids back and who are present, so we're going to go ahead right now and dismiss our children for Children's Church. All of our kids ages 2 to 13, right? Is it 2? 3. 2 to 12. 2 to 12. There we go. While the kids are doing that, I just want to make a plea to all of our members. We have a lot of things going on. Jerusalem has been growing. I am grateful to say that since March of last year, we have had over 40 baptisms. Amen. The majority of all of those folks who we have baptized are still here. Now, I need to talk to our members. I know we have some visitors, and I'm grateful to have visitors with us today, but I'm asking, just if you will, forgive us for talking, you know, in front of you like this. But Jerusalem members seem to be on different shifts. Y'all don't all come on the same Sunday. I don't know who made the schedule and who scheduled first and third Sunday and then the other crew third and fourth Sunday, but I need all of Jerusalem to be here at one time. If we were, we would be able to move some of these partitions back, because we have enough people who are currently on the roll to fill this place up, and that's a blessing. With that being said, I'm noticing that we're having more of a parking issue, because the more people, the more parking spaces. We have the parking lot here directly on the property. We have the parking lot across the street. And for those who don't know, we also have a parking lot down the street. That parking lot down the street hasn't been used. And because we had so many people, whether they knew or didn't know that it was the church's property, they started dumping on it. And it caused us a lot of problems. The city helped us, and they put some barriers up there so that the people wouldn't drive back behind it and do all of that stuff. But then they just started dumping in front of the barriers. So we're looking to put a fence up around it. We're also, we spoke with some tree services who came out. Right now we have different bids that are coming in, but we have a bid so far to put a fence up around the property to keep people out of there at roughly $5,200 to put the fence up. When we talked to the tree company was also saying maybe $3,000 or $4,000, because the trees that have grown up over the property, we got to cut all of those back and clear it out to where the parking lot is usable and it's decent. you all, I just believe that if anything has God's name on it, it ought to look like him. You all understand what I'm saying? So everything we do, we want to do it to the level of excellence. When I look at the Muslim mosque and all of these different other temples, the Buddhist temples and all of that, you all, they look immaculate. They have gold domes on the top and all of that, and you would think that their God is prosperous. Well, your God is more prosperous than theirs. Your God is the true and living God, the King of kings and the Lords of lords. And when I go to his house, it looks like it ought to be his house. The White House looks immaculate because the president is there. When the president leaves that house and goes to Camp David, that house looks good. Everything that has the president's name on it looks good. It looks a certain way. So anything that has God's name on it, especially as far as I'm concerned, where New Jerusalem is concerned, we want to make sure that it looks right. God said, don't be afraid of the need. Man, y'all looking at me. Y'all making me nervous. Y'all making me nervous. For a while, whenever bills would come up, I would start panicking. Lord, how are we going to pay this? How are we going to pay that? And God said, why are you tripping on some money? I paid the last bills. Every bill that came up, whenever we needed the parking lot done and whatever we needed, God supplied it. He said, I promise to supply the need according to my riches, not yours. So all I need you to do is let me know what you need. Fair enough. God said, I didn't ask you to pay for it. I asked you to believe for it. So we're just going to believe. Now, I'm also working with some of these vendors to see if they can give us a better price or a good price. But at the same time, I also want to pay what's fair. We're not asking people to come and per se discount their services. I believe that God, if God can give us 7,000, he can give us 10. Thing is, I need you to help supply that need. Deuteronomy tells us that God has given you the power to get wealth so that his covenant could be established. And we have not because we ask not. I know this is anniversary month, and every member or the families, the household has been asked for $250 per household. In reality, you all, that's not a lot of money. That's a one-time annual for your pastor. So let's not trip on the money. Let's not get boggled down by that. And to raise $10,000, I think we could do it. I just need you all to believe for it, and know that if you believe for it and if you are positive with your finances, God will be positive towards you. Amen. All right. So we don't have to harp on that. Somebody told me keep it moving. This month, the anniversary is here. You all, this is a great time for me. We get to look back. We get to look back and see what God has been doing under this regime, if you will, over the last 7 years. And I have seen God really move. I've seen some great things happen over the last 7 years, but I also honor my father and mother who came before us, who put all of this together. So I need you all to continue to pray. They are on the road today. They had their annual trip. Dad loves to fish, and they are in Quincy, Illinois this morning. They'll be coming back later on this evening. They'll miss the first service for the anniversary, but they will be back with us. But in the evening times, the choir, we have the musicians that are coming. The choirs will be singing. So we're not singing in the morning times, but we're working on that. Again, it takes finances. And each Sunday, if we wanted to have a musician for the services, each Sunday that would run us roughly $450 to $500, because musicians are not cheap. But if you want to dance and if you want to move and if you want to get your groove on, then you got to pay to play. Amen? Amen. If you dance to the music, somebody said you must pay the piper. So if you love me, please do me a favor. Don't skip out on me. On these services. We only have four services to show your appreciation, if you all will, the 2nd, the 9th, the 23rd, and the 30th. We have an excellent lineup for you. We got some of the top-notch preachers in the city of St. Louis that will be here. Hey, man, let me do what I'm doing. Appreciate you. Love you. So y'all come out and support. You may not have the 250, but you have your presence. Amen. And I don't want the other churches to come and outdo us and fill it up, and we're not here to say our own hellos and thank yous. All right? All right. All right. So I'm gonna go ahead now. My auntie, sweet auntie is here from Denver, Colorado. I look forward every opportunity to see her when we can. So I'm grateful that she's here. She made the trip down. Her father passed away. She came for the services. And even though it's a sad time because of death, it's always a good time to be around family. So you all love your family. You only get one. And everybody family got some problems. So don't be mad about it. Let's go. Joshua chapter 2. Joshua chapter 2, verse 1 through 14. Grateful again for all of those folks who showed up at the youth and young adult event on yesterday. I believe we had four young visitors who came and was a part of the bowling festivities, and they had plenty of food and drinks and all of that. So we're reaching out to our youth and our young adults because they need help and they need our support and they need our training. Amen. We need to train them up according to the word of God. This generation is a whole lot different in so many different ways. I can't even begin to say. If you have your Bibles and you are willing to follow along with me, Joshua chapter 2, we are going to read verse 1 through 14. I ask folks to stand, not in reverence of the man of God, but in reverence of God himself. Amen. Whenever the judge comes in, everybody stands. Whenever the president comes in, everybody stands. If you can stand for a man, then I hope that you would be willing to stand for God. Joshua 2, verse 1 through 14, reading from the King James Version, and it reads, "And Joshua the son of Nun sent out of Shittim two men to spy secretly, saying, 'Go and view the land, even Jericho.' And they went and came into an harlot's house named Rahab and lodged there. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, 'Behold, there came men hither tonight of the children of Israel to search out the country.' And the king of Jericho sent unto Rahab, saying, 'Bring forth the men that are come to thee, which are entered into thine house, for they be come to search out all the country.'" Verse 4, "And the woman took the two men and hid them and said thus, 'There came men unto me, but I wish not whence they were.' And it came to pass about the time of shutting of the gate, when it was dark, that the men went out. Whether the men went out or went, let's see here. Whether the men went, I would not pursue after them quickly, for ye shall overtake them. But she had brought them up to the roof of the house and hid them with the stalks of flax, which she had laid in order upon the roof. And the men pursued after them the way to Jordan unto the fords. And as soon as they which pursued after them were gone, they shut the gate. And before they were laid down, she came up onto them upon the roof. And she said unto the men, 'I know that the Lord have given you the land, and that your terror is fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you, and when you came out of Egypt, and ye did unto the two kings of the Amorites that were on the other side of the Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom ye utterly destroyed. And as soon as we had heard these things, our hearts did melt. Neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and in earth beneath. Now therefore I pray you, swear unto me by the Lord, since I have showed you kindness, that ye will also show kindness unto my father's house, and give me a true token, and that ye will save alive my father and my mother and my brethren and my sisters and all that they have, and deliver our lives from death. And the men answered her, our life for yours, if ye utter not this our business. And it shall be, when the Lord have given us the land, that we will deal kindly and truly with thee. May God bless the reading, the hearing, and the doing of his word. You can be seated. Let's talk from this message point. Don't discount who God will use. Don't discount who God will use. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you right now for your word. We thank you for your messenger. We thank you for the people that are here, your sons and your daughters, your children, this chosen generation, this royal priesthood. God, we thank you for them. We ask now that you will open up the ears of them so that they could hear what the Spirit is saying to the church, and that the Spirit will do his job and use me as the vessel in which you have ordained me to do, realizing that we are all broken people and broken vessels, but you use broken people. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. This and all blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. You all, I want to talk to you because there are a lot of things when we go to ask people to do different things. Most people kind of feel like they are unqualified to do the work of God. They think that they have to, you know, in order to preach the word, you have to go through seminary. And in order to, we had young people up here just a few minutes ago who was helping out to do the work of an usher. And most of them hadn't had any formal ushering training. But most often what I found out is that if you are just a willing vessel, God can use you. Now, I need you to use either your church language. Your church language is amen. Amen. That's your church language. Or if you're from the streets, you can use your good street language and be like, right on. All right? I got it. You dig? My auntie used to always say, I'm hip. So just let me know that you're here and that you're talking to me. As long as it's respectable, we can use our words, because I need to make sure that we're on the same page. Now, in the scripture, it says that the children of Israel, if I can just talk to you and kind of put the story down for you, the children of Israel had just been delivered from Pharaoh and his army, had came across, had gone through the desert, had done their time wandering in the desert, and they had made their way to what God was giving them, the promised land. Now, Joshua sent spies and said, I need you all to go and search the land. In order for them to go and search the land as a spy, they had to go in undetected. When they went in, they came to a house. Now, how they picked this house, God only knows. But they happened to pick the house of, the scripture says, a harlot. In today's terms, we would say the prostitute. This was possibly, if it was her house and she's the prostitute of the house, we're talking about a brothel. I know none of y'all ain't never been to one. I'm just saying that this is what's in the scripture. Just say amen if you believe that it's in the scripture. If I said anything that ain't in here, then y'all can leave. All right? Don't get mad. But seems like if God could use the prostitute, he could use you. Now, I'm not saying that the prostitute is the low of the lowest, and I'm not also saying that they are the high of the highest. But what I'm noticing is that God seems like he can use anybody. The problem that I have with church folks is it seems like in your youth, most of us have courted death. In our youth, we have done things, you know, we just didn't think that death would come for us. We were invincible. You drive down the highway, no seatbelt, 100 miles an hour, dodging in and out of traffic, and you just felt like death would never come for you. You could, you know, the stuff that we did, I don't know, we didn't use a lot of good judgment. But that's why they say sometimes wisdom comes with age. The younger that we are, the usually the less wise we are. But there are also some old fools. I know some people with a whole lot of gray hair just as dumb as a doughnail. Amen. You know what I'm saying? You dig? Y'all with me? But God had brought the children of Israel through the Red Sea into the wilderness, and now they have come to the doors of the promised land, and we need to go and search it out. And they get to the harlot's house, and she lets them in, and she says something that ought to give you some hope. She said, oh my God. You know, if she was talking to them or sending them a text, she would, OMG, what is really going on? I done heard about y'all. Jerusalem, do you know that people have heard about you? Not only have they heard about you as a people, but I come to find out that people are hearing about New Jerusalem. I go certain places and they say, hey, aren't you that preacher from that church over in Ferguson? I said, that depends what you heard about it. What do you know of us? Because all news that's been disseminated about you ain't good news. And all the bad things that they are saying ain't a lie. Sometimes, brothers and sisters, people will say things about you that are true, but it's still bad. And when we were growing up, we would hear things like, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words would never hurt. I understand the sentiment, but if I tell you the honest to God truth, that's not always true. Because words do hurt. If you ever had somebody that you loved say something to you that just cut you so deep. Some people never have to raise their hand, but the people that you love could say some things to you that will cut you to the bone. The problem is, or the resolutions, what will you do to fix them? What will you do to if there is a problem, will you just get mad because somebody said something, or will you do something to change the problem, to make yourself better? This woman who was a harlot said, I've heard about you all. I've heard about these children of Israel. We heard about your God. I don't care who you're dealing with. I don't care what denomination, what nationality. Everybody who you will come across at some point have heard something about the Lord God Jehovah. Now, they may not know extensively who your God is, but let me ask you something. How will you represent him? For some people who haven't heard about God, they only know God by how you act. Do you know that sometimes the only Bible that somebody will read is you? So, what does the book of Johnson say? What's the book of Artisha saying? What does the Proverbs of Brandon say? When somebody reads your book, what does it say? Does it say, blessed be the Lord God of Ferguson? Or does it say, if that SOB come back over here, I'm going to beat her? Your life, for the most part, is an open book based on how you live it. But some of you all are putting too much information out there for other people to see. If I went to your Bible book called Facebook and read right now your Bible in here, is it appropriate? How many people volunteer right now for me to go to their page and read it out loud? Some of y'all shouldn't raise your hand. I'm just, and the only reason why I say that, because I done been to your pages. And if I like your post with one of these, I'm kind of letting you know in my own way that might not have been as appropriate as you think it. You know what I'm saying? But the children of Israel had a reputation, and their God went before them, and the people heard about them. And this woman says, I heard about your God. I heard about what your God is doing. And listen, I don't want no part of them in a bad way. We know that we, the heathens, we know that you all have the true and living God, and we don't want that smoke. We really ain't about that life. If people were to tell the truth, most often, whenever you walk up on somebody, okay, I can't speak for ladies, but I can talk. I can kind of talk for guys. When a bro walk up, I size him up. I want to know, do I need to hit him at a distance? Can I get close? Or should I just get a stick, beat him, and run? Because you kind of look at people and you kind of figure out, you know, it's that self-preservation. When you're walking down the street and you see somebody and they look a certain way, you wonder, do I need to cross the road? Do I need to grab my purse a little bit tighter? You know what I'm saying? You kind of size people up. Well, when Satan sees you, he sizes you up. But he's not looking at your physical, because we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against principalities and spiritual wickedness in high places. When Satan sees you, do he get nervous or do he go, I wish a brother would? Some of you all are so weak, Satan has no problem with you. There is no fear of you. Does he fear your father? Yes, but Satan knows how much of a relationship you have with him. So he knows whether or not your prayers are effective, because he knows how you live. And if you live funky Sunday night through early Sunday morning, then he knows you're not a threat. Use your words. I'm not coming after you. I'm talking about people who y'all know, not y'all. Y'all, every time I preach, y'all always act like I'm talking about y'all. I'm literally preaching to the choir. You know, we're talking about the people outside, the other folks. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but, you know, so it's the other people who do wrestle against flesh and blood, not y'all. So y'all be like, amen, on them. All right? Or at least fake like I'm not talking about you. Don't nobody else need to know. I'll just give it all away. If I said, you know, there are prostitutes in here. If you stand up and say, leave me alone, they know I'm talking about you. But if you don't stand up and say nothing, nobody will ever know. Lord Jesus, please forgive me. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Okay. Listen to what I'm saying. Let's get. Many of us, we pass judgment too much in the church, and we're looking at people, and we try to decide who is fit for God to use. And that's a problem, because you were delivered, and if God was good enough to deliver you from whatever your problem was or is, then God is still powerful enough to deliver somebody else. And I need you to know that even if you haven't been fully delivered, God can use you even in your sinful state. This woman hadn't been saved yet. This woman hadn't accepted. Well, back then, there wasn't Christ to accept. We're talking 1,000 years or so prior to Christ's arrival. But she hadn't been indoctrinated into Judaism. She wasn't a Jew or a Hebrew. She was one of the heathen folk. But God still touched her heart and used her. And then, let me show you something. Go to James chapter 2. James chapter 2, verse 25. Reading it from the New International Version. Let me know when you got it. Let's move quickly. James is New Testament, so if you're in the front of the book, you keep moving. James chapter 2, verse 25, NIV says, in the same way was not even Rahab the prostitute considered righteous for what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and sent them off in a different direction. Do you know that even in, y'all, I'm finna mess with you and your theology. She lied to the king to hide the saints, and the Bible says God was pleased with her for her deception and called it righteousness. This is not me saying it. The word of the prostitute was considered righteous for what she did. Well, what did she do? She gave lodging. She hid them. She covered them. She gave them free passage. But in some of you all are wondering, God, I've been so messed up. I done done so many things. Or you're probably saying, Pastor, you saying a lot of things in the past tense. I'm doing some things that I know ain't right. I'm doing some things. I get up in the morning and my heart is wicked. I'm doing it and I want to do, and I'm enjoying my sin. I know, I'm talking about the other people now, y'all, because I know you don't enjoy your sin because, well, no, I guess I'm lying. I guess you do enjoy your sin. Because the flesh is fighting every day with the spirit. And you all, if somebody cut me off, if my mouth was still flipping like it used to flip, I'd get happy endorphins when I would cuss people out. I felt good about it. I told them, I gave them a good piece of my mind. You all, when I was clubbing and drinking heavy and smoking like a chimney and whoremonging and promiscuous living and all of that, y'all, I felt good. I enjoyed it. I was happy. 1997, when I left and was getting ready to start college, I took 2 or 3 weeks and did some traveling before I went to the college. I spent a week in Sacramento, and then I went to Denver, and I spent a week with my aunt. We was talking about this last night or night before. You all, she had to be at work at like 7 or 8 o'clock in the morning. But when I came to town, first thing we all went to Applebee's, me, her, and my other aunt, and we sat in there and we ate. You all, Applebee's used to have this little plastic apple that they put all of the mints in, and the idea was for you to take a mint when you left or when you came in. You all, when I left, I just picked up the bucket and walked out, and my aunt was like, "He finna start." And we did. We did. You all, we went, me and Auntie went out every night. Every night. Now, I slept most of the day because, you know, we was out all night. And she was like, "Nephew, I'm tired. We can't do it again." I'm like, "Yes, Auntie, we got to do it again. We got to do it again." And you all, I had just enough money to buy a whole lot of drinks from the bottom shelf. Y'all understand top shelf and bottom shelf. You know, you either get Crown or you get Mad Dog. You know, and you can buy one bottle of Crown for what you can get 7 bottles of Mad Dog. So we got 7 bottles of Mad Dog, and I'm like, y'all, the point that I'm making, let me just get to that point. We had fun, to us, to me. Fun. Got to a club, and I said, "Auntie," she's like, "What, baby?" I said, I ain't gonna tell y'all that story, never mind. When you sin, it makes your flesh feel good. But it ought to, if you have salvation, it ought to hurt your spirit. You ought to feel bad about being disobedient to the Holy Spirit. But don't sit and lie to yourself to say that you ain't a sinner. And if you ain't gonna lie to yourself about saying that you're not a sinner, then don't be looking cross-eyed when sinners walk in the church. And now you want to pass judgment and act like all of a sudden that your sin don't stink. And now what you have done is you have caused that sinner that came in looking for something. The people who are coming in here, most of them, they ain't coming to rob the place. If they are, we got all these bros in here, and I have them dressed for a reason so that you know who the bros is that's in here. And some of these bros are recently saved. So they was fighting last week. Don't come up in here tripping. Because just don't, okay? But when these people come into church, and they come looking for something. They're coming looking for an answer. They're coming to look for a God that can help them in their situation. And then you sit there and say, because they came with a scuzz cap on, or they came with a short dress or a tight fitting, and you say, you shouldn't be in here, and you make them feel subconscious. And when a woman comes in, you give her a blanket to wear inside the church because you're afraid that your man gonna be looking at her. Well, then that's a problem with your man, not a problem with the lady. We forget how God used us. We forget how God changed us. We forget how God is still working on us. All of us are a work in progress. But God can use you where you are. when we talk to so many people and they say, Pastor, I do want to come, but as soon as I get myself right, I'm going to come. Well, brothers and sisters, if you could get yourself right, most often you wouldn't have got yourself wrong. So the idea is to come out of the rain before I give you a towel. Don't stand in the rain and ask me for a towel to dry off. It defeats the purpose. This is where you come to get right. And all of us in here can use some get right. There's a lot of people who say, Pastor, almost every Sunday you talk about your past life because I'm talking to somebody new every Sunday. Every Sunday there's somebody or somebody is going to pull up this video and they're going to want to know, can God use me? And I need them to know the vessel that God is using right now. See, you don't know what I've been through. You don't know what I came through. You don't know what I'm going through. And if I... The Bible says they overcame by the blood of the Lamb and by the words of their testimony. If I don't testify, then you don't know what all God have done. And you might think, well, Pastor was just a liar and, you know, God can work with a little lie. Well, no, first of all, I was a liar, but not a little one. Y'all, I don't think I ever told a little lie because everything I do off the charts. Everything I do big. I don't go into a place unless I'm willing to take it over. Every job that I've went to, when they asked me, where do you see yourself in 2 years? I said, owning the place. Big personality. Now, sometimes that's helped me and sometimes it hurt. Because they said, sir, this is a government job. Yes, sir. Way before Obama, I was going to be president. But everything that I do big. So when I was a sinner, I was a big sinner. I was a good sinner. CEO of hell. Devil asked me for advice. But when I decided that when I said, God, I can't do this no more. It's not conducive. It's not helping me. It's hurting me. When I realized that I wasn't even serving myself and that I needed to do something that was better, when I began to have kids and I asked myself, do I want my kids to be really, do I really want them to be me? Mother's Day, Lady Adams got up and she was preaching and she said, ladies, when you get up in the morning and you look at yourself, do you want your kids to emulate you? And you all, there were so many, oh, yes. And I'm thinking, oh, no, 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 no. And that's no, I'm not dissing you. But the problem is sometimes when you look at yourself, you see something. But if you compared yourself to God, if you compared yourself to Christ, then are you really proud? And some of you all don't know what kind of shape you in. When you live in a particular environment, that environment becomes the norm. So when you start judging things, you're judging things based on where you are and your environment. So I grew up from 1981 till 1992 when I left for service. I grew up in this house right here in the front. Most of my family lived within maybe a 5 to 10 mile range of here. We had a few who was, you know, maybe over in Alton. We had some in Kinlock, some in Berkeley. But for the most part, they were within this geographical area. So everybody who I knew was almost in the same situation that I was in. I didn't know what prosperity looked like because as far as I was concerned, I was prosperous because I was norm. I wasn't hungry, so since I wasn't hungry then, as far as I was concerned, I was full. It wasn't until, because growing up here, There was no reason for us to leave Ferguson to go to Ladue. There was nothing for my grocery store was here. Northwest Plaza was the place to hang out, if not Jamestown Mall. And all the people who hung out here went over there to hang out. So I'm still hanging out with the same group of people. So there was no reason to go to Chesterfield. There was no reason to go to Maryland Heights or Ladue or Wentzville, God knows, Wright City and all of, you know, Lake St. Louis. I knew there was a lake in St. Louis. But it wasn't until I went to service and I got out of my area and I saw how other people was living. And I said, I could live like this. What do I need to do for the come up? When I began to see more, my appetite for more increased. So I need you to have a greater appetite. The Bible says, they that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. But whatever you hunger and thirst for, whatever you develop an appetite for, that's what you'll begin to eat. When I was in this house up here, we had pork steaks. That's what, you know, and when we put something on the grill, it was a pork steak or a pork rib. And those were the steaks that we were used to eating. My next door neighbor, Mr. Duffy, he would come out and he would put T-bone steaks on the grill. And I go over there and I'm looking at his steaks. Man, your steak red, my steak white. Man, that's thick too. Yours is real thick. And then he would cover it with garlic, and I'm like, what's that? We don't use that. We just use salt pepper. And because our meat was so hard, we put tenderizer on it. And then my grandmother told me, baby, why you putting all that meat tenderizer? Because it's tough, Granny. She said, do you think it's going to stop working once you eat it? What that mean? She said, baby, the same thing that it's doing to that meat is going to do to yours when it get inside of you. Be careful what you eat. Oh, drop the seed. But now I see T-bone steaks smothered in garlic. And, you know, now I've developed a taste because to me, and he would have the little martini with an olive. Couldn't stand olives. Blech, nasty. But if I want to be like him, I need to have the drink with an olive. 15 years later, they put 3 olives in mine, you know. Yeah, make it a double. Hunger and thirst after, what are you hungry for? He said, if you hunger and thirst after righteousness, but if you hunger and thirst after money, if you hunger and thirst after men, some of y'all are so thirsty. I'm gonna wait. Some of you all don't know what you're worth, so you're willing to accept anything. A man who will only call you after 11, who will only see you in the dark, who won't take you out in public. Some of you all have made God into a booty call. Pastor, I'm not like that. Sure you are. You only call them when you get in trouble. The only time you have a prayer life is when all hell done broke loose. When your kids are in the hospital or in jail. And the only time that I get a phone call from you is when everything else done went bad. And listen, we're not saying that that's abnormal. You all remember the woman who had the issue of blood? You remember what the scripture said about her? The Bible says after she had spent everything that she had, when she had nothing left, God was her last resort. But God still blessed her because she came. After you have tried everything else, can you still say, God, I heard about you. I remember mama talking about you. I remember grandmama talking about you. I remember daddy talking about you. And he said that you were a way maker. He said that you was a lawyer. God, I got a child right now that's going through some things and they facing some serious time. Has anybody in here ever faced some serious time? See, you are, I don't have time to just go through how many times I was facing serious time. You all, everybody in prison ain't guilty. And everybody on the street ain't innocent. And isn't it amazing, and I ain't being political, I'm just pointing out some facts to you. Isn't it amazing that most felons can't vote, but we got a felon running for president? He can go to, listen to this. They're going to do the sentencing in July. He can go to prison and in November still be voted president and will pardon himself. The system ain't for you. I'm just going to leave that there. But I do know that God is a lawyer in the courtroom. I have faced some serious jail time when I thought that my attorney wasn't any good. My attorney told me I'm getting ready to go and have drinks with the prosecuting attorney. I said, I need you off my case. You should not be friends with the person who's trying to put me in jail. He said, Alonzo, if I can talk to them, I can find out over some drinks what they got. I said, so what you're saying is you're going to buddy up with them to try to get some inside information. He said, yes. I said, you can stay on my case. See, I didn't know how it worked, but I come to find out that God was actually working for me before the attorneys was working for me. So when I tell you that God can use anybody, brothers and sisters, first of all, what they said I didn't do. But there was a whole lot of other things that I did that nobody found out about that I really should have went to prison for. There have been a whole lot of things that I've done in my life that nobody knew, or I just got off because of a technicality, because God knew I wanted to use you later, so that when somebody else came in, I didn't try to point fingers at them. God would remind me, son, to whom much is given, much is required. And because I forgave you, you ought to forgive as I did. Now, I'm dealing with folks now who go, oh, I can't stand them. Do you realize you were them? They're annoying. Do you realize how annoying you are? Do you realize that if you weren't my family, I wouldn't talk to you? You all, I don't like everybody I pastor. Now, I'm not talking about you. I love all of you all. Mostly. But there are some people who God got that are just irritating. But he says I'm supposed to deal with them according to their ability, the same way God deals with me. Do you know how many times a day God looks at me and goes, oh, that guy's getting on my last nerve. Just do some things and God goes, that ninja. You know what? I'm finna kill him right now. And I thank God the Bible tells us that Jesus Christ is our advocate. That right before the judge was getting ready to pronounce sentence, Jesus said, hold on, I object. I want to plead his case. But he's guilty. Yes, sir, I understand that. I understand he's guilty, but He has a you. Let me read some people, and you tell me maybe if you might fit in any of these. Some broken folks. Matter of fact, can we be transparent just for a minute? If I call off some things and you fit the description, raise your hand and keep them raised, if you will. Now, some things might be extremely personal, and I'm going to read some very personal things about some of the folks in the scriptures who have been really broken. And you might find other things to raise your hand on. Or if I say, like, for instance, Elijah was suicidal. The prophet, the great prophet, the one of the most powerful demonstrations of God's power. But Elijah was suicidal. When I talk about Elijah being suicidal, you may not want to raise your hand because you don't want nobody to know that you ever thought about taking your own life. But if I was to be real honest with you all, there was a time when I was ready to take my life. I started giving things away, didn't realize that was one of the symptoms. The spirit of suicide came up on me because I thought my life had gotten so low it wasn't worth living anymore. Not knowing that God had an answer for it. But Satan tried to blind me. But if I read off something and you fit the description, Abraham was old, Elijah was suicidal, Joseph was abused, Job went bankrupt, Moses had a speech impediment, Gideon was afraid, Samson was a womanizer, Rahab was a prostitute, the Samaritan woman was divorced multiple times, Noah was a drunk, Jeremiah was young, Jacob was a cheater, David was a murderer, Jonah ran from God, Naomi was a widow, Peter denied Christ three times. Peter was also one of the most prolific cussing Christians that you would ever run across. But I know most of y'all should have y'all hand up right now. Martha was a worrywart. Zacchaeus was a small person and money hungry. The disciples fell asleep while praying. Paul was a Pharisee who persecuted Christians before becoming one. Miriam was a gossiper. Sarah was impatient. Moses was impotent. Jeremiah was depressed. Isaiah preached naked. Some of y'all should have all your hands up and your feet up. Why? Because everybody has been broken, but God used some of the most ratchet people. You all, I wouldn't allow David to be the head of my men's ministry. But David, the whoremonger, the male prostitute, the most promiscuous man probably in the Bible, a killer, a deceiver, a liar, but one of God's greatest prophets, had the voice of an angel, could play a guitar, handsome. Wait a minute, am I talking about me or am I talking about him? Anyway, but the Bible says that he was a man after God's heart, the apple of his eye. How could somebody, God said, I said righteous, and y'all heard ratchet. David. But that's the one who God said I could use, not because of his faults, but because of his heart. Some of us got some problems in our flesh, and the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. You all, sometimes we find ourselves in the middle of doing things, and your spirit becomes so broken, Not that you didn't realize what you were doing, but because you were so weak to the temptation. And the temptation took over and caused you to fall. And when you, the Bible says, when the prodigal son came to himself and realized, I'm a man of royalty sitting in a bunch of mud and feces, eating the slop that the pigs are eating. When I know I could go home and take a bath and could come out of these rags and put on a royal robe. There was a time this week when I looked at where I was at and realized how much the sin had made me disgusting. And the Bible says to flee, to run away from youthful lust. When I thought about, my granny would say things like, baby, when I look back over my life and I think things over, I can truly say that I've been blessed. I got a testimony. When I think about the goodness of Jesus and all the things that he done for me, when I thought I was going to lose my mind, when my parent died and I thought that there was no way out, when my child died and I thought that I would never get over it, and he said, you don't have to get over it, but you can get through it. And God takes me every day as I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And he said, I fear no evil because God is with me. His rod and his staff, they comfort me. Every year, about this time, hell breaks loose in my house. Almost the last 2 or 3 years, almost at least one Sunday out of the anniversary, the wife is in the hospital. 2 nights ago, 3 nights ago, 4 o'clock in the morning, and I hear her. She's moaning. She's in pain. And I wake up and I say, honey, what's up? What's going on? She said, my head, that headache, that tension headache, I feel it is coming on. I tried to go find the medicine, and the medicine, I couldn't find what I wanted. So I'm just trying to wait it out. You all, in a matter of 15 minutes from the time that I was speaking to her to 15 minutes later, she was screaming in pain, and I'm trying to get her dressed so that I could take her to the hospital, and she's saying, no, please, no. Now, the tears are flowing, and she's grabbing her head, she's rocking, and she's saying, I can't take it. But then she's saying, don't take me to the hospital, and I'm saying, we gotta go. I can't sit here while you're going through and just let you go through, because it's not getting better, it's getting worse. And before you have an aneurysm or a stroke or a heart attack or whatever, we got to get you somewhere. Now, we done already prayed and we done touched and agreed and we done all of this, but it seemed like God wasn't answering when I wanted him to. But we started trying, you all, we took the pills for the headache. We took coffee. We took blood pressure medicine. We took, I don't know if maybe it just, she overdosed a little bit and it just calmed the nerve. I don't know. But we took everything, including prayer. But after 15 minutes or so, she started saying, it's easing up. It's easing up. It's easing up. I kept saying, you know what? I was expecting the hell, because every year Satan attacks us during the anniversary month. You all, as much as I'm excited about the anniversary, I can't wait till July. Lord, get us through June. Just get us through June. What's your situation? Where are you at? What's your spiritual debilitation? What is your problem? What is it about you that you think God couldn't bring you up here? If I was to ask anybody, if I was to just spin in a circle and find, and the point landed on you, and I said, I want you to come up and give us a word from the Lord, what would be your excuse on why you can't? Is there anybody in here that God have done something for? If God have done something for you, do you know that you can tell somebody about it? You don't got to come from St. John. Young man, how you doing? Good. I'm glad you're here. Did that young lady invite you? She's a good young lady. I like you. Thank you very much. What's your name, sir? Ramil. You raised your hand when you said God did something for you. I'm not going to call you up. Y'all. But you can come from the book of St. Ramil to tell somebody what God did for you. And even though it may not have came from the scripture, it'll come from your heart. And it'll mean something to somebody. You all, as I get ready to close, I got a lot of scriptures and other stuff, but hopefully the point has been made on, one, don't pass judgment on nobody else, and two, don't pass judgment on you either, because sometimes we are our own worst critic. Sometimes the person who you really need to forgive ain't somebody else. Sometimes you have to forgive yourself. Because truly, there are very few people in the world who know how bad you are but you. But because you know, you are harder on yourself. And you think, right now in Bible study, we're talking about temptation, and we started on this past Tuesday. If the Lord will, we're going to talk about or conclude on this Tuesday about how to detect when Satan is tempting you, how to know the difference between Satan tempting you and God testing you. But the next lesson that we're going to talk about, if the Lord will, is what to expect when you become a Christian. Because somebody said, Pastor, this is what I want to learn about, because I thought that once I accepted Christ, everything was going to be all right. That I wasn't going to have to cry no more. That every day I was going to be happy and smiling. And I realized that I seem to be dealing with more hell now than I was then. And I wonder, am I doing something wrong? And the church, unfortunately, has been telling people, when you come to Christ, your life is going to be better. Now, that's partially true in the spirit realm. But physically, in the earthly realm, Satan is going to come after you. The Bible says, for as much as Christ suffered in his flesh, arm yourself, because you finna start. There is no Christian life without suffering. And the problem is, most of us don't know how to suffer. We have some people who they have a very low tolerance of pain. You have to be, this exhibition fight that's getting ready to come up with Mike. What? They canceled it? You joking? Y'all don't make me mad. Don't make me mad. That postponed. Okay. Okay. All right. All right. All right. This fight that was going to happen, or it might happen. You all, Mike is powerful. Yes. Mike is one of those people who I told you about. If he came in and I looked at him, that I don't fight Mike. You know, I shoot Mike. You dig what I'm saying? And I shoot him far away. Far. Because Mike looked like he could even take a bullet. Maybe a couple. So I need to make sure that he's far enough away from me. But if Mike could punch but couldn't take a lick, because a lot of folks got knocked out in the first round from Mike, but almost all of them at least got one hit. If you can't take a hit, you need to know that when you accept Christ, God is going to give you power, but he never said that I wouldn't allow you to get hit. Most of us have taken some blows, some things that have caused our heart to break. But let me ask you a question. Some say it is better to have loved and lost than never to have loved at all. I don't know all of your personal situations. And I'm careful. But I have seen what God have taken some of my family through. A few years ago, my aunt lost her son. And in our private conversations, I said, Auntie, it hurts right now. A twin. Would you, if God would allow you to go back and erase him to where it never happened, would you have rather have still had all the years that you got to love him and got to play and got to laugh and got to do all of those things to erase this hurt? Even though this hurt is detrimental to the soul, but all the years that God gave us with him, would you erase it? She said, no, I wouldn't. I hate the hurt. It's so hard to deal and at times unbearable, but I could not imagine my life without him. Brothers and sisters, Satan has fiery darts that come and they pierce you to your very soul. But somebody says, but I wouldn't take nothing for my journey. To know what God has brought me through. Brothers and sisters, my wife and I have been through, we're counseling people now. Oh yeah, we're counseling now. But we were going through counseling some years ago. Matter of fact, we was going through some counseling last year. I think that every married couple ought to stay in counseling. Because what it takes to get there is going to also take to stay there. So you shouldn't only go and see, you know, you should go for a regular checkup for your doctor visits. Some of us need to be under the constant care of a mental health professional. That don't mean you're crazy, but you want to keep from going there. For as much as God have done for us, regardless of who you are and where you've come from, regardless of your problems and your hurts that you've been through, do you know that it's because of what I've been through that I am who I am? It's because of all of the problems that was in my marriage that now when people, every time we go to counsel somebody, and they say, but you don't know what I'm going through, preacher. See, you a preacher. My wife looked at me and she started laughing. I said, man, lady, y'all don't know where we come from. Y'all don't know what it took for us to get here. But it's because of what God allowed us to go through that so that we could sit here with you now. Used to wonder why we going through so much hell. So, sweetheart, all the times that I did all that bad stuff, it was because God needed us to go through it. No? Okay, I'm sorry. I digress. All right. Regardless of what you've been through, regardless of what you're going through, and do me a favor, stop trying just to invite church people to church. Find somebody who's going through some real bad stuff. Listen, there are a lot of churches right now who are ordaining homosexual bishops and same-sex married couples as pastors and all of that. That is not God's law. That is outside of what God wants. But if you know somebody who's dealing with homosexual problems and issues, bring them here. Because if God can't fix the problem, and they might say, I don't have a problem. But many of us didn't know that we had a problem. You didn't know how bad. I didn't know that I was living in a place that was somewhat impoverished until I left and went to a place of prosperity. I didn't know what good health looked like until I got away from everybody who had diabetes, who it was natural to have pork for breakfast, pork for lunch, and pork for dinner. And everything was salty, and everything had to have Kool-Aid, red, thick. Bring somebody who needs the same help that you received, and understand your spiritual disability does not disqualify you. It actually qualifies you. God uses the broken, because if you don't know that God is a healer, you can never tell somebody who's been sick what God can do. The doors of the church is open. This is, when we say the doors of the church is open, somebody may not know what it means. And there are a lot of people who may not have come from a church environment. And they said, well, preacher, when you said the doors of the church is open, I thought that was time to go. We just got up and walked out. But the doors of the church being open is the opportunity. This is where, if you don't have a church home and you are looking for a church home, you can come and be a part of this church home. Now, there are different ways that you can come. If you have not accepted Christ, the first thing that we want you to do is to develop a relationship with Jesus. You need to know that Jesus Christ is your Lord and will be your Savior. You need to know him. And maybe you want to accept Christ but don't want to join this church. I'm okay with that. We are more about the kingdom and not about your membership. There are thousands of churches in St. Louis, and it doesn't matter what denomination, we can make sure if there's a particular denomination, we will research, because we know churches, Church of God in Christ, Apostolic, Pentecostal, Lutheran, AME. I will make sure that you get to some place that is a Bible based believing church, because that's first and foremost. But you may want to come as you've already accepted Christ and you're just looking for a church home. There are some people who say, Pastor, for me, when I was out of town, I never changed my membership from New Jerusalem. But I would, because I was in the service and I was stationed somewhere, I would join a church under watch care. So there are some people who say, I'm in between two states. And I don't want to leave my church, but I need a covering. Brothers and sisters, if you are a Christian and you talking about you in between churches, and I ask you how long have you been in between churches, and you say 2 years, there's a problem. You cannot be married to God and not come home. You cannot be married to your husband, my newlyweds. Do he come home? He do come home. Good. Good. This would have been real bad if that backfired right now. But what if he only came home once every 3 months? How long would y'all be married? But you love the Lord, and the Lord knows your heart, and you go to church once every 3, 4, 5, 6 months talking about, I don't have to go to church to be saved. I'm spiritual, not religious. You's a lie. That's what you is. You cannot say that you love God and have a relationship with him and don't fellowship with him. Something is wrong with your salvation. And if you think you're comfortable, if you are comfortable living in sin, maybe we need to talk about if you are saved. Because the Bible says many have honored me with their mouth. There is somebody who quoted Romans chapter 10, but that don't mean you're saved. Because you could say it with your mouth and don't believe it in your heart, and the Bible says you're going to go to hell. And you can be a preacher laying hands on people and they get healed and they raised from the dead and you will still go to hell. Y'all need to stop following people because they got signs. Because they can hoop real good, because they church is full. There's a lot of sinning churches that's full. I won't go into that. Anyway, this is your opportunity. I want to say thank you. Thank you once again to all of our visitors. We see that there is none, but yet there is room. I don't want to hold you all day, because if I do, I know you won't come back tonight. And I need you. Jerusalem, I need you. I need at least how many people? I'm going to make you either tell the truth or I'm going to make you lie. How many people will commit to me that, Pastor, I will be back here at 3:30? How many people will let me know that today that they're going to come back for service? Amen. Huh? The 4 hours from now is too far away? Now, if you're not coming back, I'm hoping that you're not coming back because maybe you have to work. And if you have to work, I understand that. But if you don't have to work, I want to ask you, for you to think about this yourself. Where is your commitment to me? Are you as committed to me as I am to you? Because I do work. I work a lot. I'm operating 3 full-time businesses every week. Because this church is more full-time than any of my other full-times. And if you call me at 2 in the morning and say something just happened and you need me there, first of all, I have to wake my wife up, because I have to, especially considering who you are, I need her to come with me. And I got to be at the hospital with you until such a time that I have to leave and then go to work again. But if I love you that much, the same love that God has for you. Because I'm so glad that God don't treat us like we treat him. I'm so glad that God, he don't just talk to us when we don't talk to him. If God only talked to you as often as you talk to him, so you wouldn't even know who he is. But I'm asking you, Consider your commitment. And if you cannot be committed to this ministry for whatever reason, you may want to consider if this is the right ministry for you. Maybe we're not giving you everything that you need. Every church ain't for everybody. So I understand that, you know, whereas you may have started here at this church, this church really don't fit your personality. And that's okay. And I will still give you a good recommendation to go to whatever other church. But I want you all to consider your commitment. Amen? Would you do that for me? Hopefully that the Lord will use you and speak to you and guide you in everything that you do. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6 says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not into your own understanding, and in all of your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct you. Ask God where you should be. I'm grateful. This young lady who came, she said, Pastor, I have a church, but my car broke down, and I could not be in church. So I needed to be in somebody's church today. And she walked to church. So I'm grateful for her and for her commitment to her God, not just her church. Because this is still God's house. And even though I may not know what church she come from, I know the God that she's a part of. And anytime I can go to my father's house, whichever house it is, it's his house. I'm always welcome in my daddy's house. Amen. So you all, as we now begin to go into our communion service, I need you to change your mindset. I need you to change your mindset because we were having fun, and I hope we were having fun, and there were some laughing moments when we were having the ministry to go forth. But my Uncle Robert used to say things like, Nephew, I'm as serious as a heart attack. The communion is a very serious part of the service because Jesus says, when you do this, as often as you do this to remember me, to remember my suffering, to remember how bad it was for me. This is not a laughing time. This is not a time that I'm playing with the babies or combing hair or liking somebody's post or whatever. My focus. My focus has shifted, and it's serious because I'm thinking about all that God did for me. The Bible says that while Jesus was with his disciples, basically he had his boys, and they was all sitting at the table. And he said, as often as you do this in remembrance of me, to show forth my suffering until I come again. And when I come back, I'm going to receive you to myself, and then I'm going to take you to be with me and my Father. So if you would be ashamed to own me before other people, then I'll be ashamed to own you before my Father. This is a righteous moment. This is a moment of reflection. And in funerals, they play soft music and they say, read the obituary silent. This is our opportunity right now to reflect from Jesus' birth to his death, to remember everything that he went through so that maybe you wouldn't have to go through it, or if you go through it, you can realize God went through it first. And if he went through it, he made it possible for me to go through it. If you've experienced the loss, God wants you to know, I know what that feels like. I never had to be separated from my son until he died. I didn't like it, but I had to go through it. And Jesus said, I went through all of that and rose again so that you would know that death wasn't the end. Brothers and sisters, as we prepare to bless everything that is going to be consumed, I want you to remember how much God did for you. And yes, if I could just guilt you and put a small guilt trip on you. If the old saying that fair exchange is no robbery. For as much as Christ did for you, if you have received salvation, for as much as Christ did for you, Is 6 or 7 hours a week really too much to give back to God? He gives you 168 hours every week, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And he asks for 2 hours on Sunday morning, maybe 2 hours on Tuesday night. 4 hours right there. We don't really have many other all-the-time services. So 4 or 5 hours is all he asks. And you make excuses for those. I'm so grateful that God don't do us like we do. Let's bless this. Father God, we thank you right now. Lord, I understand that what I'm holding right now, it's really just some wheat and grain and the excrements of the grain. But in the spirit sense, it symbolizes your body and your blood and what you shed on Calvary and how your body was broken. Literally, the skin and the flesh broken to pieces. But God, I thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for giving us your son who went through a horrible beating and was crucified the most horrific death that was known to man. But he went through so much because, God, somebody in here is going through so much. Somebody is dealing with some issues in their mind. Somebody is dealing with some issues in their spirit. Somebody is dealing with some physical ailments, but they beat him and whipped him, but by his stripes we were healed spiritually and physically. We call it done. God, we ask right now that you would bless all that is going to be consumed on today, and that as it enters into their body, the same way my grandmother said, maybe that meat tenderizer is going to tenderize on the inside. God, I pray that as we take meat and eat and partake of the body and the blood, God, that in some spiritual sense we are ingesting meat, and that you will manifest from the inside. You said it's not what goes in a man that defiles him, but it's what comes out. So I pray right now, God, that you would bless it, that you would change it from a carnal to a spiritual beast. We ask this right now in your son Jesus. Amen. Let us take the body and let us eat it together.
Oh, how I need you.
Let's take the blood and drink it. Let's give God a hand clap of praise for everything that he's done. I know y'all can do better than that. I just said, give God a hand clap of praise. I'm grateful for everything that we've had and had accomplished. I appreciate you all sticking with us today. I know it's a few minutes past a normal time because of the Lord's Supper that we're partaking, but we do have visitors. If our visitors would like to have a word to say, we just want to be courteous and give our visitors an opportunity to address us if they would like to. If they don't, you certainly don't have to. But if you would like to have a word to say. Amen. Hallelujah.
As the pastor said, my car is down right now, and I've only been in this area since February. And we can't go to anybody's house, even though it's labeled church.
Right.
Just like in the natural, you have some people who make you welcome out of their mouth, but when you go there in person, you can feel their spirit.
Yeah.
And you're not welcome. But I can honestly say when I came through the doors this morning, I felt hospitality from the heart. And even just walking through the church, I see the excellence of God in the house. And he gets the glory.
Yes.
He gets the praise. He gets the honor. So I thank God for leading me here this morning. I prayed in my prayer time this morning, Lord, I don't go no anywhere. And he ain't going to send us no anywhere. That's why he said the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord.
Yes.
So I said, Lord, I need a backup. Do I have a backup this morning, Lord? I won't know unless I go there. So I thank God for the backup.
Yes.
For the backup. And I thank thank God for the pastor's transparency. Don't change.
Yes, ma'am.
That's who God made you to be. Don't change. Don't change.
Yes, ma'am.
If they don't fit, they don't fit.
Amen.
God bless you all.
Amen.
Amen. To God be the glory. Once again, we thank you all. We hope and pray that this message and this service was a blessing to you. Today we have Archbishop Stephen Thompson, who will be bringing the word, and Pastor Fred Lemons, who will be alternating. So the Leonard Missionary Baptist Church, under the direction of Archbishop's son now, my friend, Stephen Thompson II, and Pastor Fred Lemons II will be here today to kick off this anniversary. They have done that from day one. So I'm asking that you all will please come back and be with us. We're looking forward to not only for myself, but for my family. You all do me a favor. Give the first family a hand clap of praise. I would not be able to do the ministry that we do if it had not been for them. They operate the cameras, the sound, the music, everything. First Lady who puts together and does things to the point of excellence. We don't do it half done. So I'm so grateful, and I want you all to come back and don't just celebrate me, but celebrate my family also with me. So if all hearts and minds are clear, let us stand. Father God, we thank you right now for your people. Lord, I thank you for being a good backup. Lord, so many churches that are open in your name, and we are not competing against churches to churches, but I thank you that we were in a position. And Lord, if she said that the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, God, if you ordered her here, there got to be something good about this place. And I'm grateful that we are a church that's open in your name to every and all people. I pray right now, dear God, that as everybody make their way home and to their destinations, that you would give them the heart to think about this ministry and this family who have done so much work for them over these last 12 months, that they would come back and celebrate with us for everything that you've done. We praise you and we give you all glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen.